nothing special, because I know if I can feel it, you all can too. We all serve the same God. Amen. We come to worship Him this morning in songs and prayer and in testimony. So we asking you all to come to your feet, and we just started in praise of the Lord. I love to praise Him. I love to praise His name. I love to praise Him. Oh, I love to praise His name. I love to praise Him. Prayers go directly to Christ. It's no good to pray to me or the pastor or the deacons or the trustees. They are aimed towards Christ Jesus. So let us all come in whatever way we see fit and bow our heads just for a few minutes and let God know that we love Him. Make us worthy of your blessings. Oh, Father God, we just love you. We glorify you and we magnify you. And Father God, we ask of you to money to unto those who are less fortunate than we are. There are those that would love to be here to praise you this morning, but for some reason can't. Then there are some who could be here, but just wouldn't array themselves to come out to praise you, Father. But I'm so glad that you put it in the hearts of these thy people to come out and give praises unto you. We love you. We magnify you. We give your name the glory. In Jesus' name, amen. We'll ask you now to turn your hymn books to hymn number 223. Solid Rock, hymn number 223. Say amen when you have it. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not the sweetest thing.
It is therefore as grasshoppers, that stretches out the heavens as a curtain, and spreadeth them out as the first tent to dwell in. Yea, they shall not be planted, yea, they shall not be sown, yea, their stock shall not take root in the earth, and he shall also blow upon them, and they shall wither, and they and the whirlwind shall take them away as stubble. Lift up your eyes on high, and behold, who hath created these things, that bringeth out their hosts by number. He calleth them all by names, by the greatness of his might, for that he is strong in power, not one failed.
Why sayest thou, O Jacob, and speakest, O Israel, my way is hid from the Lord, and my judgment is passed over from my God?
Hast thou not known? Hast thou not heard? The everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, fainteth not, neither is weary. There is no searching of his understanding.
He giveth power to the faint, and to the dead that are blind, he increases the strength.
Even the youth shall faint and be weary, and the young men shall utterly fall off.
But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength.
Thank you. Sometimes it's mind-boggling to me as to the different tests that many of us have to endure in terms of dealing with the divineness of God. Sometimes I think he's trying to be common. But the things that he have us to deal with, it is to show us when we're weak and when we're strong. And when we're strong, we can become stronger. And when we're weak, we can become the strongest in that pool. Amen? It's praying time, and every day should be a day of prayer. Project Amy Miriam coming to lead us in our moments of meditations. Let us not to forget to include Brother Adair in our prayers, and Brother Richard Crouch in our prayers, and those who are listed on our bulletin, and Brother David Roundtree. I don't know if you know it or not, but God has a work for you to do. Amen. And before you can do it, you have to be pruned. Amen.
Amen.
Amy, would you come and lead us in our moments of meditation?
Happy Thanksgiving. Thank you, Jesus, for lifting us up during this day. Thank you for blessing us during this season of Thanksgiving. Protect us from harm. Wash over us day and night. And bless us. And also, Jesus, as you hold us in your arms and wash over us and lift us up and keep us close to your heart. And bless us every day. And when we shed tears, some kind of wipe them away. And protect us from hurt and sadness. And keep us close to your heart. And we want to thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. We thank you. We thank you. We thank you. We thank you. Thank you, Lord, for everything. In Jesus' name I pray. Thank you. Amen.
Oh, yeah. golden, 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 golden strand. When it's all over, let me find rest. Thank you, Jesus. Be
Don't run! testimonies today and songs today to lift you up. Lord, we thank you for your word, that pure word, that life-changing word. Now, Father, I pray for those that are here and may not be saved. Lord, would you help them to believe in their heart, confess with their mouth the Lord Jesus, and Father, that you have raised them from the dead, and you said they will be saved. Let them know it's by grace through faith that they're saved, not of themselves. It's a gift from you. Lord, we love you and we magnify you. Now, Lord, I approach you. You know my infirmities, my hang-ups, my sins. And ask you to forgive me of my sins and to cleanse me of all unrighteousness. Therefore, Holy Spirit, I welcome you again. You have never failed. So we ask you to teach us, to guide us, to lead us into all truth. Would you make this word so plain, so easy to be understood, that even a small child can be transformed to be like you? Would you be my eyes and my seeing, my mouth and my speaking, my heart and my understanding? Thank you for that anointing that gives us rest. Touch us at depths of our hearts, Lord, that we may be more like you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Are you ready for God's word today? If you don't mind, could you grab those Bibles with me and open them to the Old Testament, Numbers, Numbers chapter 23. Numbers chapter 23. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers 23. And I want you to go around, come down to that 11th verse. Numbers 23 and 11. Numbers 23 and 11. It reads, "Then Balak said to Balaam, 'What have you done to me? I took you to curse my enemies, and look, you have blessed them bountifully.' So he answered and said," in that 12th verse, "'Must I not take heed to speak what the Lord has put in my mouth?" Listen to those verses again, Luke, Numbers 23 and 11. "Then Balak said to Balaam, 'What have you done to me? I took you to curse my enemies, and look, you have blessed them bountifully.' So he answered and said, 'Must I not take heed to speak what the Lord has put in my mouth?'" I want to speak from the subject today. Your blessing is on the way. Your blessing is on the way. As we enter into the book of Numbers, a wonderful book. I say that about all the books of the Bible. But it gives us the history of the wanderings of the children of Israel. It takes its name from the two numberings of the Israelites, the first at Mount Sinai and the second on the plains of Moab. This particular book stands in a time frame about 1444 to 405 B.C., almost 39 years, this 1405, 1444, that God uses and uses the children of Israel in a mighty way. It's an amazing book because it begins to deal with God being God by himself. As we jump into this area, this Numbers chapter 22, just want to give you a little brief history so you'll be on the story with us. We find out that as Israel is going around in circles in the wilderness experience, that God is actually blessing them to take over enemies one by one. Even though that they're belly aching and crying against God, God's grace is still upon them. King after king is falling until finally they get to a king called King Og. He is defeated, but this sends up alarms around the person that we're going to deal with today, Balak. Now, Balak is of Midian, and he's a Moabite, and he sends for Balaam that we're going to be really focusing in on. And Balaam is known what is called a soothsayer or magician. We look at him and the scriptures will bring up his prophetic side, but he's really on the devil's side, but he can still hear from God. Some of you didn't hear that. He's really on the devil's side, but he can still hear from God. There may be some devil worshipers here today, and you are running for the devil, but you still have an ear to those sensitive things of the spirit. Now, what do you do when you've got a soothsayer, a magician who's brought in as a prophet, who does not really want to do what God says, but God is still in charge? Remember, they send their high officials, Balak does, and he wants to pay this prophetic man, this soothsayer, magician, he wants to pay him to curse the children of Israel. He sends person after person, and Balaam is smart enough to realize, I can't fight against God, but the money gets higher and higher, the officials get more stalwart, and they become a higher authority, until finally Balaam gives in, and he goes with those back to the Midianite area to curse the children of God. I wish I had time today to talk about the donkey that he was riding on, and the donkey had to talk to him. Yeah. God had to open up the mouth of a donkey. It's in the book if you never read it. Yes, he used a donkey, and he spoke to Balaam that he was on the wrong path, and that God would have killed Balaam right on the outside of that, sitting on that donkey, if it had not been for the grace and mercy. So the reason that we're dealing with this scripture now and Balaam is not dead is because God loved the donkey more than he loved Balaam. There ought to be some amens in the house. There's some of you that are alive today. It's not because you were so great and so grand. God just loved the donkey that you played with more than he really loved you. And to kill you, he would have had to kill your donkey. But aren't you glad for his grace? So finally, Balaam, he gets to this chapter that we're going in, that Numbers 22, and around that 41st verse, we find out that now he comes forth. So it was the next day that Balak took Balaam and brought him up to the high places of Baal, that from there he might observe the extent of the people. Your blessing is on the way. Balaam has got there. The money has clouded his mind. And remember, he had done these soothsayings, these magician acts solely for money, that he could be lifted up. So what Balak does, he takes him to a high place. He takes him to a mountainous area, and he wants him to look over the children of Israel, for he figures if he can see the children of Israel on the top, he can be able to get a better curse. That's why your enemy sometime will rise up above you, and they will think that they're all of that in a bag of chips. It's bigger than you and where you are. So many people want to become a manager, and you want to do that, and I commend you. You get your degrees and you climb up that high ladder, but never forget, if God had not been on your side, there may be some sanitation workers in the house. There may be people that work for others that are in the house. It's okay. It's not about your degree. It's not about your level of understanding. It's about if God is on your side. There's some managers and people that make six figures plus that are in this house, and they will let you know it's not about the money, because they wish they could go back and work at McDonald's again when there wasn't so much pressure, but it's about the calling of God on your life. From there, he might have observed the extent of the people. Look, as he goes to that mountain, if you can walk with me, and he looks down and he sees all the tents in the valley. This is amazing, because most theologians believe that the children of Israel had multiplied to an extent. They were millions plus in that valley. And everywhere they went, they would set their tents down when God told them. God would lead them a fire by night and a cloud by day. All the people that were around, all the nations knew that the Israelites were coming through. Numbers 23:1, then Balaam said to Balak, build seven altars for me here, and prepare for me here seven bulls and seven rams. And Balak did just as Balaam had spoken, and Balak and Balaam offered a bull and a ram on each altar. Now this is important. We see Balaam here. He does some sacrifices. Those that have studied the Old Testament, you'll realize something that sticks out here. God only had one altar. Remember that. God only had one altar. Now this messes with our minds why these seven altars. What had happened is the Midianites, who had came from that base of just Jewish society, they had decided that one altar was not enough, but now they can actually build more altars, and the more religious you come, the closer to God that you get to. But they didn't understand it's not by their acts of righteousness, lest any man boast, but it's always been by God's Spirit. God asked for one altar. So when we began to multiply our efforts to do contrary to what God says, we find out that the enemy can come in. How many of us have tried to do so much stuff within ourselves, but God didn't tell you to do it? And because of that, you are stressed out. Because of that, you're going through. Notice Balaam tells, build seven altars for me here and prepare. I need you to do sacrifices, but that is not what God called him to do. Now, there's another part. We find out that Balak does what Balaam says. Now, as we look at Balaam here, he gives the command, but Balak, the king, follows what Balaam tells him to do. Now, this is interesting here as we go to that 23rd chapter and that third verse. Then Balaam said to Balak, stand by your burnt offering and I will go. Perhaps the Lord will come to me and whatever he shows me, I will tell you. So he went to a desolate height. Your blessing is on the way. Now Balaam, he goes forth. Balak has actually done that altar. But notice at this point, Balaam, all he does is give the command. But Balak, the king that wants him to curse, is doing all the work. Naturally, we can understand Balaam thinks that he's in charge. He's diverted death by being on that donkey. He's getting paid to come and curse. And now he's on the mountain looking over the top of the children of Israel. I need to let the enemy know today, just because you have been elevated, just because you're looking down on me, just because you can command people to do what you want them to do, does not mean that you're in charge of me. Just because you've got more money in your bank account, drive a finer car than me, does not, you don't think to the point that God is not using me. I found out, if somebody remember when the Pintos were out, you can drive a yellow Pinto and still God be on your side. You can still lift up your hands in spite of what you're going through. And you may not look like nothing, but I want you to know if there's some folks in the house that can call on the name of the Lord. I don't care about your Mercedes or your Cadillac. I don't care about your new Chevrolet. If you can't call on the name of the Lord and get a prayer answer, what is a nice looking car to me? Your blessing is on the way. If you look at that third verse in that 23rd chapter again, notice what happens here. He goes into a desolate height. Balaam had the sense to know that if you want to hear from the Lord, you need to get quiet. Listen to young people and middle-aged people, and oh, we're in a society that's charged with noise. We go to sleep with noise, and we sleep with noise on. We get up with the TV on. We put our earbuds on. I see young people. I live about two blocks from UNCG, and they walk to class with music on. They can't even see me coming around the corner, and they don't know how close they came to getting run over. They just got noise going in their mind, but there's some witness in the house. If you can get to a desolate place and get quiet before the Lord, then you might be able to hear a word from God that can help you on your test. You might be able to hear a word from God that can encourage you in your relationship. It's not so much about the noise, but it's about the voice of the Lord. Numbers 23 and 4, and God met Balaam, and he said to him, I have prepared the seven altars, and I have offered on each altar a bull and around. Your blessing is on the way.
So we see Balaam is there. He's hearing from the Lord now. He's in that desolate place. Balak has already put those altars that are out there, even though it was contrary to God's will. I found out that you can be out of the will of God and God can still find you. That's why we got so many saved folks in the house. But don't you think that many of these people, all of these people got saved right here in Ebenezer, but some of you got saved in the nightclub and some of you got saved at the toilet bowl. You know why you were there? Because it was because of the night before. And you cried out to the Lord and God met you right there in the nick of time, because you knew if you'd have taken another line of what you were taking, or you would have drunk another cup of what you were drinking, you would be dead right now. There's some overdose folks that are in the house. And no, if it had not been for God's grace and mercy, even out of the will of God, he found you. Balaam is talking to God, and remember I told you before, he said that I did this, I built this, but remember Balaam didn't do anything, but King Balak did all the work. But he comes to this point, and sometimes we as people, we can get to the point because God has blessed us so much, we can think that it's all about us. Yeah, we can think really that we're so smart on our jobs, and then when we get elevated and we get in those positions, our chest gets puffed up and our head gets all big, and you forgot when you used to be sweeping the floor, but now you got the audacity to look down other folks that are around you. Never forget where God brought you from. I'm telling you, just as quick as you got to the point that you had, you can be back down again. They're giving out pizzas all over Greensboro now, all over North Carolina. Just because you've been at a job 15 and 20 years, don't think you're going to be there for retirement. It's about God's grace and he being the provider. Balaam didn't do anything. Balak did the work. But look at this. Look at this. Numbers 23 and 5. Then the Lord put a word in Balaam's mouth and said, return to Balak, and thus you shall speak. So he returned to him, and there he was, standing by his burnt offering, he and all the princes of Moab. Your blessing is on the way. Now, I must put out before you, there's tension in the text for me here. I don't know why God really speaks to Balaam, but he does. He had done the altars wrong. He had gone to the place where God told him not to go to. He was a soothsayer. He was a magician, but yet God still spoke to him. The Lord just didn't speak to him, but he put a word in Balaam's mouth. If you can walk with me and just give me a few moments here, that lets me know even my worst enemy, even if they're demon possessed, even if they own my track, I still gotta have my ears open, because God may slip up and put a word in the devil's mouth for me. Do I have any theological walkers with me today? Look, Balaam is not for God. Balaam is against God, but yet God is so powerful, so awesome, so big, so magnanimous. He puts a word in Balaam's mouth and said, I need you to return to King Balak, and I need you to speak to them what I tell you to speak. That lets me know sometimes God will overtake you. You will think that you're going to cuss somebody out. You will think that you're going to do this and that. And has God ever got you right in the midst of somebody? Know what I'm talking about? You were ready to put such and such in their place, but you stood there. You were demon possessed. You had all kinds of issues going on the inside, but God said, shut your mouth, and he put a word in your mouth, and instead of cursing them, you began to bless them. Now, it seems to indicate that God drops this word in Balaam's heart, but Balaam does not know all the details of it. All he knows is that he has a word from the Lord. He goes back, and there he has an audience. He has Balak there, and he has the princes of Moab. But notice here, the word begins to come out, Numbers 23 and 7, and he took up his oracle and said, Balak, the king of Moab, has brought me from Aram, from the mountains of the east. Come curse Jacob for me, and come denounce Israel. A verse, how shall I curse whom God has not cursed, and how shall I denounce whom the Lord has not denounced. Your blessing is on the way. Now, I put the context on Balaam and Balak and the princes, but please note the children of Israel are in the valley. It seems like they're struggling at this point, even though they had win after win, they're having a hard time listening to the voice of the Lord. But even in their disobedience, God is still covering them. Now, let me give you the reality of this scripture. Balak was called, he said here in this scripture, that seventh verse, he said that I was called to come cursed Jacob. I was called to come denounce Israel, but when God began to speak to me in secret, he gave me a different word. I'm telling you, some of you are looking at your situation as a cursed situation, but sometimes you got to step back. Maybe God has called that which you call cursed blessed. Notice this, Balaam has been paid to curse the children of Israel, but when he gets a real word from God, all of a sudden he gives a prophetic word, and this should just rock yourself today. If you think about, he said, how shall I curse whom God has not cursed? You need to tell your enemy, how can you curse me? You need to put those words back in your mouth, because I understand something. It's not about me anyway. I've got issues in my life. I should be called the curse, but what God has put a blessing on, if my blessing is already on the way, how shall I be denounced whom the Lord has not denounced? What this is saying, no matter what you think that you're at, no matter the issues that you're going through, if God is on your side, no matter your money situation, no matter your job situation, no matter your body situation, if God has said you are blessed, you are blessed. That's why he said we can walk by faith and not by sight. Have you ever thought about what you're going through right now to just be a test to say, God, I trust you in spite of? Balaam, the one that's been hired, the magician, the soothsayer, how shall I curse whom God has not cursed? Now, I'll be honest. The only way that I'm able to stand here today is by the grace and mercy of God. I understand I was conceived in iniquity. That means from the mother's womb, sin was already there. That means that I incurred the curses of God. But somebody knows about the grace and mercy of the Lord. In spite of my genealogical line, I don't have perfect mom or perfect dad. I love my mom. I love my dad. But they got sin in their life. And I realized that I love all of you here, and you look real nice today, and I smell you. You smell real good, and you got nice clothes on, but I know there's some sinners in the house today. I know you sang those songs, and you were clapping your hands, but to stand here and not believe that some of you ain't sinned even today, that some of you ain't gone through some stuff even on yesterday, I know you can understand. God, how can you bless even me after all that I've done? Are there some real, I don't want to lift up real sinners, but are there some real sinners in the house? I'm not telling you to sin, but some folks that can think back 5 years ago, think back 10 years ago, think back 20 years ago, and if God kept that stuff, why are you here today? How can you dare stand up and praise him? It's all because God changed the situation. Your blessing. Now, this is the issue. Balaam's saying, I can't curse them. I can't even denounce them because God is blessed. I know you paid me big bucks, but God has overridden my soothsaying. He's overridden my magician's acts. And I can't produce a wand to mess with him, because when I try to do that, they're already covered. There's something that's over them that I can't get to. It's blocking me from putting a curse on them. It's a covering. I'm just talking to a few folks in here. I want you to know. It wasn't because you were a great driver yesterday. You saw that car. It was crossing the line, but it was a covering that was around you. It was some ministering angels that I know, Tyrone. I know I should be dead. I've been through too many stuff in the military. I know I should be dead. But God's grace and mercy. There had to be some angels around me. There had to be some kind of covering on me, because the enemy wanted me out. Your blessings on the way. I remember as a young child sitting in East White Oak Missionary Baptist Church, and I was young child, probably about 5 or 7 years old, somewhere in there, I had a seizure. And in the midst of that, my grandma, as I went down on that pew and fell down in the midst of the service, all she knew was to do, we want to keep him from swallowing his tongue. And I know that may be something that's an old wives' tale, but Mom, my grandma took her fingers and she stuck them into my mouth to keep me from strangling on my own tongue. And I realized that the day that the devil attacked me right in the house of the Lord, doing praise and worship, and he wanted to take me out, but God kept me. I woke up some hours later in the hospital looking around, and I remember seeing this little girl that didn't have but one leg, and I said, God, thank you for the legs that I got. You know what, can I give you one more example? That my blessing was on the way. The devil wanted to take me out. I was at the ice cream truck one time, and I was on Pine Street on my bike, and I pulled out in front of the ice cream truck, and all of a sudden all I saw was a car that was coming at me, and I realized that if it hadn't been for the angels there, I would have been flat as a pancake. That car slid all the way up to my bike, and then were inches away. But I knew something now. I didn't know it then, but the angels were and kept all around me. I had a covering on me. The devil said, now let me take him out as a little child. The devil said, let me take him out at the ice cream truck. And I can give you an example after example. But God said, I ain't cursed them. I put a blessing on him. He don't look like much like nothing right now, but I want you to know he got better work to do. I believe there are some folks that are in the house today. You just don't know how blessed you are. You've been belly aching, it said before, complaining, but God wants to use you. Matter of fact, if you just think back a few days ago, he already used you. You just missed it. But if you can just speak and touch what God wants you to do, God can change some things. All right, Numbers 23:9-4. From the top of the rocks I see him, and from the hills I behold him. There are people dwelling alone, not reckoning itself among the nations. Your blessings on the way. Balaam, as he's speaking the oracle of God, he speaks and he tells them something. When I looked over the people, I saw a million plus of them. I noticed something. They weren't like us. They had separated themselves, and they were people that were dwelling alone. And I want you to know, in this society, we need some real Christians to stand up. We need folks. I'm telling you, we are in the world, but we're not of the world. You've got to realize the more that you're in the Bible, the different that people are going to look at you. You're not going to talk like them. You're not going to connect with them on the same basis. You're still going to love them. But Balaam understands these people are dwelling alone, and they're not reckoning itself among the nation. What he was saying, they are separated. They even look different. Their tents look different. They walk different. They talk different. There's a covering on them. How can I put a curse on them? Numbers 23:10. Who can count the dust of Jacob or number 1/4 of Israel? Let me die the death of the righteous, and let my end be like his. Your blessings on the way. Now, some of you didn't get what he said right here. He begins to look at them. He's trying to get a curse out, but blessings keep coming. He said, look at them. Look, I'm trying to number them, but I can't even get my numbering system right. When I count one, another one pops out. And I count three, and somebody else, two more comes in. And some of you said, the songwriter said it like this, count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God has done. I tell you, sometimes I look at my house and look at my family, and I say, God, you done blessed me. When I began to count the numbers of the blessings, I don't have enough breath to count all the blessings. Balaam said, I'm looking at Israel, I can't even count them all. They are multiplying. God has blessed them. And then he does this. Listen to this. Let me die the death of the righteous, and let my end be like this. Balaam is saying, listen to what he's saying. He's telling the Moabite. He said, you know what? I came to curse these folks, but the more I look at them, I want to be just like them. That's what he's saying in the scripture. He said, let me die. They are righteous. God has called them righteous, and I want my end to be just like them. You know you got some power in your life when the devil all of a sudden said, I want to be like a Christian. When the devil is messed up by God's righteous acts in your life. Now, I say it again. Please understand, it's not about you, but it's all about the power and the mercies of the Lord. Anybody know if it had been you, you wouldn't be here today? But when the Holy Ghost get on the inside of you, Brother Roundtree, it'll make you cry when you don't want to cry. It will drive you to love the Lord even when you don't know what love is all about. Look at Numbers 23:11. Then Balak said to Balaam, what have you done to me? Your blessing is on the way. Look at this. I took you to curse my enemies. And look, you have blessed them. Obviously, amen, huh? This is my verse today. King Balaam is upset. He built the altars. Sacrifice. Now Balaam comes back with a word, but it's not what he thought it should be. Jacob is going to multiply? You want to be like them? They are separated? That's not a curse. What have you done to me? And as he said, I paid you. Put you up in a nice hotel. Gave your donkey some food. Gave you nice clothes, new shoes. I took you to curse the Israelites. Now you're giving blessings to them. I'm telling you, when I look at the life of the church, in spite of where we are, in spite of what we've done, God has blessed us. I can say here today that all the stuff that's going on in our nation, that's going to go. God has already prophesied. But you got to know this is the finest day for the church. In spite of us making mistakes, in spite of us having our own ways, in spite of us not opening our Bibles the way we should, God is saying, I'm still going to use you. Do you know the enemy is laughing at the church? They're saying that we shouldn't worship and praise like this. Keep it quiet. Don't lift up your hands. You can go to that church, but don't make an impact. Don't pray. Don't tell us about Jesus. You can come and pray at our events, but don't use the name of Jesus. But notice that 23 and 12 as we pull it together. So he answered and said, must I not take heed to speak what the Lord has put in my mouth? Balaam says, I can't help it. I tried to do what you wanted me to do, but now the word of God has overridden what was in my heart. After this, Barak suggested that they go to another hill and try it again. The king Barak, he said, and Balak and the others, they said, let's go to another hill. Maybe God allowed you to curse the children of Israel. But I want you to know, no matter where you go today, you can't curse that which God has blessed. No matter what situation you find yourself in, you may be cursing at yourself. Are there any folks that ever cursed at your own self? But I want you to know, you can't curse what God has blessed. If you've been blood bought in the house today, the Holy Spirit is on the inside. You are a blessed person. I'm not concerned about your circumstance, your situation. You could be sleeping on the streets today in a cardboard box, but as long as you know that Jesus is on your side, please note they take him to another mountain. The mountain was called Pisgah, and this is very important in the historical background. We found out that this is the same place that Moses would come to, and he would look over into the promised land, but he would not be allowed to go. Maybe God was prophesying sometimes, no matter how good you think you are, without the grace and mercy, you will not make it to the promised land. But I'm so glad today that your blessing is on the way today. I can tell you affirmatively that no matter what you're going through, as said before, God is on your side. It doesn't matter what the doctors have said to you. It doesn't matter what you're going through mentally today. But if you can hold on to the promises of the Lord, please note that Balaam makes about three attempts to curse the children of God, but he still couldn't put a cursing on them. But the blessings were still on the way. When your blessing is on the way, nobody can stop it. You're not listening to me today. When I got blessings on my way, nobody can stop it. I know that God has been good to me. No matter what the situation is, if my blessing is on the way, I may not feel like it today, but there's some people in the house know that I can still praise him and worship him. Well, eventually Israel will make it into the physical promised land, and Balaam will be tragically killed with a sword. We find that in Joshua 13 and 22, because he went against the Lord and he kept on trying to curse God's people. We find out the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. I want to speak to you, sinner man and sinner woman, if you don't know Jesus today, there's grace that's in the house today. God already knows what you've done. He knows the situation that you've been in. But if you can just cry out to the Lord, he can change you from the inside out today. But I'm so glad that my blessings are still on the way. It's not just here, no physical land and thing. Please note today that there was a time in my life that I thought if I could get bigger cars and a bigger house, that meant that I was blessed. If I could wear Louis Vuitton and I could have all kinds of leather, that meant that I was blessed. If I could have diamonds on all of my ring fingers, and then all of a sudden I would be blessed. If I could get in a plane and I could fly anywhere I wanted to fly and take extensive vacation, I thought that meant that I was blessed. If I could have a timeshare and be able to go when I wanted to go, maybe I could buy my own island, then I would be blessed. But I want you to know, it's not in the physical stuff. It's not in the things today. Some of you don't know what a blessing is today. You can't praise him because you too caught up in your car. You can't praise him because you look too good. I'm glad you got Mary Kay on there. And excuse me, Brenda, all of that other stuff. I'm glad you got cologne and perfume on. But if you can't get ugly every now and then, you don't understand what a blessing is. Maybe God has to put you in the hospital when you can't even wash yourself. You can't even think about putting deodorant on. And then you can realize where your help comes from. But I'm glad today for Jesus. He came to let us know the blessings that are on the way are more than we can imagine. In the gospel, he speaks an amazing word to a bunch of hurting people sitting on the side of the mountain, what is known as the Beatitude. Luke 6:20 said, "Blessed are you who are poor, for yours is the kingdom of God." You mean to tell me when I was poor, I was still blessed? Blessed are you who hunger now, for you shall be filled. Blessed are you who weep, for you shall laugh. You mean to tell me when I couldn't make it to a restaurant because I didn't have enough money in my pocket, I was still blessed? You mean to tell me when I lost a loved one and I was weeping, I was still blessed? And I could have laughed in the middle of the situation. Jesus said, "Blessed are you when men hate you, and when they exclude you, and revile you, and cast out your name as evil for the Son of Man's sake." You mean to tell me my blessing was on the way when people didn't want to hang with me, when people walked away from me? In school, some people didn't want to be on my side. I was already blessed. He said, "Rejoice in that day and leap for joy, for indeed your reward is great in heaven. For in like manner their fathers did the prophet." No blessing is on the way. Jesus said, when the worst of the worst is going on, when everybody is walking away, I want you to know you can leap up and you can rejoice. You can tell the devil he ain't got nothing on you, because I got my blessings on the way. Can I just preach this thing just a little bit? He was saying that God is good and worthy of all the praise. Well, Paul the Apostle said it like this in Ephesians 3:20. "Now to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask of him, according to the power that works in me, to him be the glory in the church by Christ Jesus to all the generations forever and ever. Amen." To the Christians in the house, your blessing is on the way. Romans 4:7 said, "Blessed are those whose lawless deeds are forgiven." Are there any forgiven folks in the house today? Oh, your blessing is on the way. And whose sins are covered? Anybody got their sins covered? Blessed is the man to whom the Lord shall not impute sin. Are there any folks that been justified, that your sins should have took you out? Well, aren't you glad your blessing is on the way? That's why Jesus died on the cross for us. He covered our sins with his own blood. Your blessing is on the way. They put him in a cold tomb.
You just wait a bit. I don't know what day you in today. You may be in number one. You may be in number two. But something happened on that third day. He got up with all power and glory. No blessing is on the way. John, we keep going like this. Blessings are coming my way. Thinking about it every day. As I fast and pray, I can say they are coming. And the trials I go through, Lord, I still rely on you. Patiently are waiting for you. They're coming, y'all.
Took you to curse my enemies and look you up, bless them balanced. So he answered and said, must I not take heed to speak what the Lord has put in my mouth? Father, thank you for your word. Lord, we're sorry. We have complained. But we are so blessed. We keep asking you for more. And heaven, thank you for what you already given us. Forgive us. Some of us are able to eat in whatever restaurant we want to eat. Go to the stores that we never thought that we could shop in. There's some older folks in here who just wanted to drink out of white water fountain. Now we can marry whom we want to marry. Races can come together. Black, white, Hispanic. But we keep on asking for more. Oh God.
Thank you, God. Thank you. Thank you. Oh Lord, thank you.
He told us the prayer of the righteous availeth much. But yet, we keep going our own way. Oh God, forgive us.
Thank you, God. Thank you. Thank you, God. Thank you, God.
Oh God, help us today to decide. We're going to praise you. We're going to stop being so solidified, so trying to be so politically correct, and we're going to stand on the word. We're going to love and we're going to stand on the word. Whatever we have to lose, it's all right. We're already blessed. We're already blessed. Would you save, deliver, and set free? Save us from ourselves. In Jesus' name. Our ministers come forth, our deacons, our intercessors. We give you a little time. If you don't know Jesus, would you come forth, confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, and believe in your heart that God is raising from the dead. Scriptures are very clear. You will be saved. It's by grace through faith that you're saved, not of yourselves. It's a gift from God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. That's God's grace. If you're here today, you want one of our ministers, intercessors, to pray with you. Would you come forth today? Would you please come forth? Would you come forth? God is faithful.
There is power,
salvation
in the name of Jesus.
Maybe you're looking for a church home, Christian experience of our love. Would you come forth? You know God is speaking to you. He's been speaking to you over and over again. You need a covering today. Come on, watch here. There's some college students that are here. You just need someone to just kind of hold you over you as far as a church family. Hold you accountable. Would you come for me? Take you watch here. There's some of you need to be up here for intercession. You got struggles in your life, temptations that are in your life. Your blessings are on the way. Actually, they've already been there, but you're just not seeing them. Man, would you bring them to the altar? Maybe you need to pray for a husband, a wife, a child that's going through. Would you come for me? Maybe concerned about our nation, where we are. We need to come forth today. Let's pray for God to be lifted up. I don't know what God is going to do, but I know this is a time for the church.
Come on, you declare it.
God is faithful. God is faithful. Would you come? Some of you need to just bring your families for him. Would you come? God
is faithful. There is power.
There's power in the name of Jesus.
Yeah, to break every chain.
Break every chain. Final invitation. Some of you are looking forward to a blessing. You feel like your life is just broken down. Stuff is falling apart. I want you to come forward. I want you to walk out in faith. Say, God, I receive it. Help my eyes to change. Help me to see. How blessed I am. Would you come forward? Some of you dealing with some diagnosis. You know what it is. You're not sad about it. Bring it to the altar. Would you bring it to the altar? God will work it out. You're working out.
Your blessings on the way.
Oh, he's faithful. Your blessing.
Break every chain. Break it.
Jesus bear the cross alone for all the world go free. For there's a cross for everyone, and there's a cross for me. Father, we thank you that you bless us all to have this another opportunity, O Heavenly Father, to come in this wonderful service one more time, O Heavenly Father. Father, we just said that we know that we haven't did all things in a perfect right way, but Lord, you have look beyond our fault and forgive us, allow us to live a little while longer, that we could come together and share love one with another and the Father. We just ask that, Lord, to bless each one that's here, and for those who had a desire to be here, but for some hidden cause could not be here. And Father, we just want to thank you for the wonderful message that was preached in our presence. Our blessings is on the way. So many times we prayed, Lord, and we just, you taught us about how to just to wait on you. You may not come just when we think you ought to, but you're always on time, Lord. And we just thank you, Lord, for your many, many blessings that you bestow upon us, Lord. For right now, you're keeping us, Lord, and we can just feel free here to come and hear the word and pray to you, Heavenly Father. No one is here to stop us from praying to you, Heavenly Father. We just thank you, Lord, for the golden opportunity that we have, oh Lord. And Father, we just continue to ask you to bless each and every one, Heavenly Father. Even those who don't feel well in the body, but press their way to be here and hear a word from heaven anyhow. Because it's through your word, oh Lord, that's brought us down through this many years that we've been able to live together, Lord. And Lord, we just ask you to guide us over, dear Lord, and through the storm that we may go through, Lord, that we will not forget to just call upon your name in season and out of season, Lord. That we know that soon and very soon, Lord, that we'll be cut off from this life, Lord. But while we're here, Lord, let us love one another, comfort one another, and pray for one another, lift one another up, Lord, that we would work no ill will towards no one, but to love everyone, Heavenly Father. For one day beyond this life, we'll be able to go in that wonderful place, Lord, that has been preached so many times, that it called heaven, when your heaven shall come on earth, Lord, as it is in heaven, Lord. And there we'll be in that wonderful place that was taught about in our Sunday school lesson today, Lord. But until that time, Lord, let us be righteous, Lord. And Lord, if there be anything like sin around the heart, Lord, please forgive us, Lord, that we may keep on the righteous road, Lord. And bless each one, that those who come to the altar today, Heavenly Father, for some stand in need of one thing, some another. But Lord, you sit high, you look low, and you see all we need before we even ask, Lord. So just bless us, Lord. Bless the sick among us, Lord. Bless the many broken homes, Heavenly Father, that they may be mended back together in your name. And when they're mended back together, Lord, let them put you first, that they may stay, Lord, in your wonderful name, for you are able to keep us, Lord, when we go through, Lord, and just guide us over, Lord, and let our thoughts be righteous thought. Then when we come to the end of our journey, dear Lord, we ask you to save us in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
God is so good. I am amazed at his wonders. Oh, I am amazed at his wonders. Today we've got a young man that's standing here. I want you to pray for him. It's tough looking at y'all. Really, it is tough looking at y'all. So pray for him. He's come forth and he's going to give us his name and tell us why he's standing here.
My name is AJ, and I'm standing here because I want to live better. And I want to be blessed by the Lord. I want to live by his name and not worry about struggling. I don't want to be scared. I want to follow the right path. And that's why I'm here.
Amen. Cheek has talked to him and prayed with him. He's accepted Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior. That's our true blessing right there. He's asked Christ in his heart. He wants to be baptized, but he also wants to be a part of this church. We know only Christ can save, but he wants to join this church via baptism. How should Brother AJ be received? Brother AJ, our deacons are here, near excited. They can see the hand of the Lord, what he's doing. But Ebenezer, we are the accountability partners. It's tough People can come up here and get saved all day long, but if you don't call them, encourage them, the enemy is going to be there. He's going to send his Balaams to try to curse over and over again, and they can still be blessed. But it's so good to have some partners that are praying for you. So Ebenezer, if you're willing to get to know AJ, could you just come to your feet and give God a hand clap? This is your thing. Please remain on your seats. As you're on your feet, we're getting ready to close down. God is good. Don't forget, today at 5 o'clock, we'll be over at Gate City Baptist on Hilltop. Our sister church, predominantly Caucasian. I say that simply because Benjamin, this morning or yesterday, my youngest child, he said, "Daddy, it's amazing that the church is the most racial place it is." I've known that. People tend to hang out with people that are light color, that come from their backgrounds. That's just the way it is. He said, "Well, shouldn't it be different?" It should. We have broken through some barriers, but sometimes it's still tough. We have Caucasian members. We have African American members. We got those who are Hispanic background, and we've got mixed. Hey, what do you tell them? Do you make them choose? What are you gonna be today? Be honest, all y'all look a little mixed. Haven't we gotten past Jim Crow? 1% makes you black? So why we keep trying to go back? I'm just talking to the saved folks. If you're unsaved, you're not going to understand that. But if God sees you, so God has opened up opportunities. We'll be going to Gate City Baptist. I love to be able to minister to them. God has given me another word. You know what I mean? He's given me another word for Gate City and our fellowship over there. So at 5 o'clock, come on over there. I think they're serving desserts after the service. I think it's after service. We'll be trying to start promptly at 5 o'clock. So come on out. Gospel choir will be singing again. And we're just going to lift up Jesus because God transcends all our backgrounds, the color of our skins. Finally, you remember my buddy, Pastor Daniel Rice. He stood right beside me one time in one of our services. And I call him my brother. He is my brother. And I said, Pastor Rice, hold up your hand. He held up his hand. I held up my hand. And people could not tell the difference. They could not tell us the difference. And Daniel didn't know I was doing it. He looked at his hand and looked at mine. He said, "My God, you are my brother." That's what Jesus does for us. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. As you go out this week, know your blessings are already here. You got blessings on the way, bigger than any stuff that you can obtain, but it's all about the goodness of the Lord. Gospel choir, excellent job. Would you take us home?